All right. So we just got done talking about building a business and closing deals. So let's jump into a segment of Q&A. The only thing I'll ask is if you have a question, we have a microphone there. We have a microphone there. And ideally, speak directly into the microphone so we can get a good recording. The folks listening at home can hear your questions. So I know I said someone was going to be the first question. Who asked me that? Was it you?
I think you may have answered
it. You may have answered it. Okay. Ask it anyway, and I'll change the answer slightly.
Okay. I've sent a proposal to a client.
Yes.
And after looking at your material, I didn't discuss money. And I've chased up because I know it's my responsibility, but I'm wondering what to do next.
Great, great. Okay, cool. So one thing on just pure languaging, I don't love the word chase. I do like the word follow up, because remember, you're the guru at the top of the mountain, and gurus don't chase. But gurus do follow up, okay? So I do follow up. Hey, did you get my text? Hey, just following up to see if you guys have thought more about this. I've got a couple other folks interested in this program. I'm taking two clients on right now. So it would be helpful if you just gave me a general, like I'll ask status. And I'll say it that way, by the way. I'll say, hey, I'm taking on three new clients. I've got some other folks interested in this right now. I expect this to close out fairly soon. So at the very least, give me a status of where you're at, right? And all I'm asking for is we're still thinking about it. We're still talking. And then I'll ask some follow-on questions like, is there anything I can do to help move this forward? Give me an estimate of when you think it'll take. What's the big challenge right now? Is it getting a decision maker? Like, I'm asking all those questions so that I know what's actually up, you know? If it's a decision maker thing, that's fine. Sometimes it's like, nah, you know, we were a little unclear about, and now you have some questions to answer, but nothing was going to happen until you asked that question and they started asking, right? The second thing that you have to understand, which is very, very important when it comes to closing deals, is every person in every business has its own buying cycle. So when I was marketing to attorneys, it was a solid 3 months. I'm talking solid 3 months before we were going to see a deal close on anyone that we started talking to. Attorneys are fairly skeptical people. They have their own busyness that they have to deal with. They've got their own team that they have to discuss things with. A lot of the firms that we were talking to had their own marketing departments that needed to ask a bunch of questions about how we were all going to work together and everything. And so we embraced that process, and we actually started teaching our attorneys in our training that you have to be wary of people who are quick to close a deal. And we would stick with them through that whole process and help them understand, we know this is a process with you, and we'll stick with you through the process, but I do want you to know, eventually we're gonna have to move forward or not, and let's figure out when that is, okay? And so we embrace that long process. Now, companies that have long sales processes, is that good or bad? It's just the way that it is, and here's the good news. If it takes them a long time to start working with you, guess what it'll also take them a long time to do? Stop, right? So write long sales processes, write long agreements. I'm talking like 2-3 year retainer-based agreements. A lot of times you're doing a lot of the work up front and stuff, but think about that for a minute. And if it's long, make the deal long, because it takes them, like if they decide to go with someone else, it's gonna take them forever to back out of it too. So you're probably doing the right things. Just probe. That's a better word than chase. Just probe and ask some follow-on questions and stuff. Good, thank you. Randy, thank you, Nicole.
Aren't we having the money conversation in three areas, the beginning, the middle, and the end?
Yeah. So the money conversation, thank you. So the question about money has to do with the entire conversation around the deal, okay? The money conversation in the beginning is a framing conversation. It's a way to help them understand you're expensive, right? So when I stand up on stage, I'll explain to you how I do it. When I stand up on stage, and it's the same thing when you're talking one-on-one, when I speak, I'll go, all right, now listen real quick. This is why I have this form. So this is our form for our coaching program, right? This is the $20,000 plus program. And when I use this form, I'll go, okay, now let's quickly talk about this coaching program and how you can get involved in the program, assuming it's right for you. Now, the first thing you need to know is this is an application-based program, and I talk about that. So I said, not everyone gets in. The second thing you need to know is this is an expensive program, and you might not be able to afford it. Now, most marketers would never say that because they feel like people would just walk away at that point. But when you say expensive program, you might not be able to afford it. Like I did this at a recent event. There were 100 people there. And I said, now, just so you know, I'm talking to 5 of you right now. And when you say this is an expensive program, you probably can't afford it, and I'm talking to 5 of you. If you've got a go-getter in that audience who has money, guess what they just told themselves? They're like, I can afford it. And by the way, I'm in the 5. Okay, that's what you want. That's the exact thing that you want, okay? So there's three, like you said, there's three. In the beginning, you're talking about, you're framing yourself. No real numbers, but you're framing yourself. In the middle, you're asking them questions about money. And Mike taught that in a previous segment, but you're asking them, what's a deal worth to you? How much do you make? What's your marketing budget? You're asking money questions about them. And then towards the end, you're talking specific questions about the actual deal. But if you're doing it the way that I do it, you're still asking a lot of questions, right? Range questions, deal questions. Like yesterday, I was working on a speaking deal where it started off with my first question. They had told me in the past, we had this speaker and this speaker and this speaker. And I said, so give me a general range of what you paid those speakers in the past. It's the best question I could ask because they have to answer it. They just told me about the other speakers. And now it gives me an idea of what they can pay me. So those are the kind of things that you're doing in the beginning. So good. What else? I think, Lori, did you still have a question? Okay.
So we've talked a little bit about videos and the importance of it. Do you have advice of how to get over that feeling like you're talking to a wall and how do you bring your personality? Because I speak on stage all the time, but to a camera feels so awkward.
You. I'm glad you asked that question. I will tell you, this was a challenge for me. And I didn't know it was a challenge. So I, a little frankly overconfident in my abilities. My area is a stage, as you know, similar to yours. So you put me on a stage in front of 20 people to 2,000 people, 20,000, I don't care. I'm in my element. And I could do that for hours without a break. I come up with new stuff. I literally walk, come to an event and you'll see, I walk up on stage with like a piece of paper with like three things written on it. There's nothing there other than what I brought in my brain, okay? So, and I'll do 2-3 hours like that with very little because I've done it, you know, and I really like it. But then moving from that to video or onto the camera for me was a challenge. I didn't know it was a challenge, by the way, and I didn't know that I wasn't very good 5 years ago when I first really, like, you can't work with Mike Koenigs and not do like a lot of video. So kind of like the thing, you know, and we did a lot of webcasts and we did a lot of live streaming. Okay, so there were two things that helped me really kind of connect with a video audience, because when you're looking at the camera, sometimes you're just like looking at a camera and it's very difficult to connect. Okay, so the first one was, when I would look at the camera, what I started to do, now when Mike does this, he thinks of one person. When I do this, I think of a group of about this size. And if you're watching this video, there's maybe 12, 13 folks that are sitting in the room, something like that. I think of a group that's exactly about this size. So Mike thinks about one person. I think about a group, but I think about a group because I teach in this environment and I like this environment. And I think, so when I talk to the camera, I'm imagining like some of my best clients, you know? I'm imagining Joey Osborne and I'm imagining Lori Barr, you know, and I'm imagining the folks who are in our mastermind like Satori, okay, and Walter. I'm thinking about people that I know and they're all in the room and as I'm speaking, I'm connecting with them. So when I talk to somebody, I know most of them, I know their, you know, what's happened in their lives, what's happened in their family. Like one of the ones I just mentioned just went through a very significant transition with her parents, right? So I know all those things about them and so I can speak to that. So the first thing is I imagined in my mind that I'm speaking to those people. It made me slow down. It certainly helped me connect a lot better. And we had videos, Mike and I would create videos where after 30 minutes, he's like, all right, we're not gonna use that. Let's start over. And I want you to imagine, and he would start doing that. So I would imagine groups of people. He would imagine one person. The second thing that I did, which is really, really helpful, is I started having actual people in the room, okay? So like when we do webcasts, if we were doing an important one that we were gonna use forever, like as an evergreen, I'd have 2 or 3 people that we would invite. I would have team members in here, like Nicole would be in here, Lori or folks who are members of our team. Or in certain cases, like it's not it's a coincidence, but our coaching members can come to any webcast anytime they want and observe the whole process from beginning to end. And they can just be with us for the day in the studio. But having them was also a real benefit because I could hear, like, I'd be in the middle of a joke and I could hear them snickering over there and I'm like, bam, you know? And so like, because, you know, you tell jokes from the stage, people laugh. You tell jokes to the video and you're like, you know, you don't even know if it was funny or not, you know? And so, but like in an environment like this, when people kind of laugh in the background, you're like, yes, that was really great. So, anyway, so I sat there for a minute and imagined myself as a stand-up comedian. Okay, I'm back. So that's how I do it. And it's one's a mental game, the other one's just pure physical, but it probably would help to do the second one first. Have a couple people there, you know what I mean? And then switch it over. So, good. All right, we got 7 minutes. Time for a couple more questions. Satori.
Yeah, my question is about how you structure the actual deal, your productivity, I mean, your time. How do you... Like I have a section in the morning. Like, how do you do structure your?
Oh, your, goodness your gracious!
Deal.
So, how do I structure my time around the deal?
Yeah, making itself? Deals. Yeah.
Yeah. So, okay.
To create the 80-20.
Oh. Okay, I got you. The time in my schedule to do that. Okay. Yeah. Yes. So here's the thing. There's at least three stages to this, but I'm going to talk about two of them. Okay, so there's like a training stage and then there's a sustained stage. And what I'll tell you is if you followed me around and you observed my every day, you would get to the conclusion at the end of the day that Ed has no plan at all for what he does on a daily basis, okay? And so I go to sleep at different times, I wake up at different times. Like I know people who are like, every morning I wake up at 4:30 and I'm like, some mornings I wake up at 4:30 and some mornings I wake up at 9:30, you know what I'm saying? Like. Sometimes I stay up late, sometimes I don't. My schedule's all over the place. Okay, but so at the risk of sounding a little bit arrogant, I've trained myself so freaking well that I don't need that structure as much anymore to do what I need to do. You know what I'm saying? Now, when I was training myself, so remember there's two parts. There's the train part and there's the sustain part. When I was training myself, I was draconian and diligent about everything. Okay, so I'm gonna tell you about when I trained myself because it's the stage that you're gonna want to go into. And I'm gonna tell you how my day went. Okay, so my day was very regimented. The first thing I would do is typically wake up, I would do some reading, Bible reading, prayer, 30 minutes, maybe 45 minutes, up to an hour. Work out, have breakfast, get to work at a specific time, and it was every day, 8:30 or 9 or whatever it was. The first thing I did every single day when I opened my computer, does anybody wanna guess what that was, by the way? What do most people do first thing they do when they open their computer? Check email or social. Okay, the first thing I did every day, every single day, every day. You know what it was? Anyone want to guess? Didn't write anything. Nope. Did all that the day before. Nope. Didn't calendar. Did that the day before. I'll explain what I mean by that in a second. Nope. Nothing. I would open up my bank account every day. Every single day. First thing. Chase.com, enter the password, bank account. Why? I'm taking my time away from my family and some other interests right now, and I'm going to spend this time in front of my computer or on my phone or in front of an audience, and the reason I'm doing it is because I have a business that has two main objectives. One is to get a return for the shareholder, which is me, and the other one is to create a great product or service in the marketplace. So my focus, when I first checked, I knew as the number was. It doesn't change that much on a day-to-day basis, right? But I wanted to check that first. That's the scorecard, if you will. Again, it sounds a little mercenary, but that's what I'm there doing it, okay? So I checked my bank account, okay? The second thing that I did is I went to my plan, and here's the way that I created a plan. In fact, I'm gonna go to the board really quickly and walk through this because this is kind of important. So I had this like ringed planner, and on the left-hand side, what I would have written is just all kinds of tasks, all right? And I'll tell you how they got there in just a second, but on the right-hand side, it was like a day planner. So it was like 9, 10, 11, 12, blah, 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 1, 2, 3, all the way to 5, okay? So here's what I would do. I would take all of my tasks on the left-hand side, and like I said, in a moment, I'm going to tell you how I got them there, and I would rate them 1, 2, 3, 4 in order of most importance. Now, occasionally, I would rank one or two or three that was an easy 10-minute thing I could just get done and just get it off of my plate. Okay, and then what I would do is I would assign times to each of those, okay? Write blog posts. Follow up with contacts from Friday's event, right? Send agreement, 15 minutes. Send agreement to something, something, something. By the way, if what I just said send agreement, what would that probably be on the number-wise? It would be 1. It would be 1. I know that it says 4. Okay, so then I would give times to each of these things. Okay, then what I would do is I would move over here and I would go, great, from 9 to 10, I'm going to do this one. And from 10 to 11, 10:30 to 11, or from 9 to 10:30, from 10:30 to 11, I'm going to do this one, this one. And then I would put a little break in here. I'd call it PDT, personal development time. That was just a little bit of a break, or I could check email or social. Now notice, no email, no social, no interruptions, no text, no nothing. During those times, it's blocked off, it's scripted. I've got 30 minutes on the clock to write an email and to get it sent out to my list. I've got 15 minutes on the clock to send this agreement off. And I have in my office, this is kind of interesting too, I guess, every wall has a clock and they're all like synced up. So everywhere I look, I see time. Okay, but if you get in my car, if you get in my car, none of the clocks are right. One says 8 right now, one says, 2 in the morning or whatever. All the clocks are off, and there's a reason for that. If I want to look at a clock, I'll look at a clock, but I don't want it in front of me if I don't want it in front of me. And when I'm in my car, more times than not, like when I get in my car to drive to the office, no matter what I do, it's going to take that time. You know what I mean? Like, it's going to take me 23 minutes to 27 minutes, so whatever. So why do I need a clock to be there looking at me the entire time? If I want to look at a clock, I'll look at a clock. But when I'm working, I want them everywhere. You know what I mean? Because I'm here getting stuff done. So I'd script it, bam, 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 a little bit of a break, check email, go to the bathroom, get some coffee, come back, bam, 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 okay? And that's a freaking productive day, right? I've numbered everything. Now there's some stuff late that's held over that I've got to do. Like, for example, right now, something screwed up with my paperback, one of my paperback books, and I've got to fix it on Amazon, okay? And it's been on my list for like 3 or 4 days because, frankly, it's not that important of a money-making thing, but it still floats on my list, okay? So now, the next day, what I'll do is I'll flip the page, I'll take what's left here, and on the new page, what I'll do is I'll write my new list. And I do this, my last half an hour of every day is exactly like this. I call it squeezing the sponge. Okay, and what I'll do is I'll sit there, no email, no text, no interruptions, and I'll think through all the businesses and I'll think through all the projects and I'll just start writing a whole bunch of stuff down. Every task, everything, no order, no priority, nothing. I'm just writing it all, I'm dumping it into a piece of paper and I'm putting it all down. Now, have you ever been like, just as you're falling asleep, you're like, I forgot to email Bill, you know? If you do what I just told you, that doesn't happen. Because your mind just puts it all out there and your subconscious goes, he's got it. And then you dream well and you sleep well and you don't worry about stuff when you're having dinner with your kids or playing soccer, okay? So I squeeze the sponge, all that stuff, I write down all that stuff, and all of that ends up onto the next day. And then what I do is I put numbers and times next to everything, and then I go to the next day and I go to the next day and I go to the next day. Okay, that's what I used to do when I was training. Okay, what I do now is I wake up and I do what's required to do the most important thing for my business at the exact most important time. Because after years of doing that, it's already ingrained. You know what I'm saying? So I don't get interrupted. I don't waste a lot of time. My goal is every minute of every day is a purposeful minute of every day. That's the entire day. And every piece of media that comes my way is a purposeful piece of media that comes my way. So everything I read, everything I listen to, everything I watch. Like the other night I watched Gladiator. You ever seen that movie? That's a great movie, by the way. I watched Gladiator, extended edition, 2 hours and 54 minutes. But I chose to watch that for a specific reason. You know what I mean? And it was a very specific reason, and I'm glad I did. There's two books that I read the last two nights that I read for, you ever read Call of the Wild, Jack London, and White Fang? Dang, required reading, okay? Especially for you men, go read it now. I'm not kidding you. Go, close your deal first, go read Call of the Wild. It's important for you to read it. You need it badly, okay? Call of the Wild, Jack London. Read Call of the Wild first. Side point. Okay, so I want all of my time to be purposeful. I want all my activities and media to be purposeful. And the third thing is, I want every thought to be purposeful. So you know how you're just driving and then you're like, what have I been thinking about for the last 20 minutes? That's weird. Or you like walk into a room and all of a sudden you get upset or anxious or angry and you're like, where did that come from? Like, I felt great this morning. That's because something else is deciding what you feel and what you think. And my goal is I want every single thought and everything that I entertain to have been placed there by me for a purpose. And that includes leisure too, by the way, but for the most part, I want all of my time, all of the media, and all of my thinking to be purposely placed there by me, and that's what I'm training myself to do right now. That's a longer answer to the question that you asked, but it gives you an idea of certain things and how people do certain things. What I'll tell you is the training is worth it. The training is hard, right? Doing that on a very consistent basis is freaking difficult. But the training's worth it, because what happens is, I was teaching my kids this the other night. I'll end this whole Q&A segment with this. I was sitting at dinner with my two boys, and I was talking to them about training, because, you know, they're like, "Dad, it's hard and I don't want to do it." And I'm like, "Suck it up." You know, I don't say it that way. And I said, "Do you know what the word training comes from? Do you know the word train? Do you know where that word actually comes from? Does anybody want to guess, by the way? Not the noun, the verb, train. You know where it comes from? Agriculture. Specifically, what kind of agriculture? Wine, vines, grapes. Because if you take a grape, plant and you just put it into the ground and you let it do whatever the hell it wants to do, what will it do? It grows on the ground, and what happens to the grapes? They're nasty, dirty, and moldy. It doesn't produce good things. Okay, so what you do is you take the thing and you start wrapping it around a post, and you start pulling it, and you start cutting it, and you start stressing it out a little bit, right? You give it a hard time. I'm telling my boys this last night. I'm like, but what you get when you're done is what? Really good grapes. So I said, when you're growing up, who trained you primarily? And they're like, God. I'm like, I know God's the answer to every question, but primarily, who trained you? They're like, you. And I'm like, exactly, your parents train you. When you're older, who trained you? And they're like, ourselves? Exactly. And I said, so the point is, you should get to the point at some point where you begin to train yourself. Okay? The problem is, and I won't go too far down this road, the problem is in comfortable America, because we didn't get trained properly, we didn't get trained properly on how to train ourselves. And we don't understand that it actually hurts sometimes. And it's actually hard sometimes. But the fact is, the hard training creates the peace in the future that you actually want now, but you can't get it without the training. It's true for physical stuff. It's definitely true for mental stuff, which is what I'm working on the most right now. And it's definitely true for your time. So the key for your time right now is to be a hard-ass drill instructor for yourself up until the point at which you just got it. You know what I mean? And you have to do that, and you have to be diligent about it. I know that I said that was the last thing. This is the last thing. When you start being a hard-ass drill instructor for yourself, who does it also start to affect? Some of the people around you, like your employees who are used to talking to you whenever you want to, or texting you for everything, okay? Or your assistant who can't leave you alone, or your husband or your wife who doesn't understand the difference between the work hours and what's important. So here's the thing. When I'm done work, I'm done. But when I'm working, I'm working. And my wife understands the fact that when she gives me the time here, this time here is uninterrupted. And everyone else we know, everything's interrupted by everything, but we get that, draw really clean lines. Okay, so we've set a structure up that's like that, that's initially hard for everyone, but eventually better for everyone. You with me on that? I should do a whole event just on that, for crying out loud. I'm telling you, we could go some places with that one. Maybe I will. All right, we are going to take lunch. Are you ready for that? If you are, say hoorah. I'm gonna wrap this segment. Was that helpful for you? If it was, say hoorah. Hoorah. Okay, thank you.